The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good afternoon, and thanks for coming on by. I'm Steven Jackson with Imprintables Warehouse, and you're at a great garment graphics webinar. Today we're going to talk about Versaworks 101, a little bit of workflow how-to. We're going to take a job from beginning to end and show you a lot of the tabs and buttons and everything that's in Versaworks that can sometimes be a little overwhelming, and hopefully show you the process and answer some questions along the way. This is going to be a fairly quick-paced webinar because there's a lot to setting up a job and running it, and I'm going to try to cover as much of it as I can with possibly going back and adding on a couple of buttons if we have time and making sure we leave enough time for any questions and answers, of course. So we'll go on to the next slide, and as we go into this slide, Nicole's going to bring up some poll questions. I want to get them out there and get them answered right away and see where everybody stands. So the first one is, what model of VersaCam are you using? Maybe you've got the new BN, the SP, one of the older models, or the newer SPs, VP or VS, or possibly none at this time. Just trying to get a feel for where the audience is and what they have out there right now. So we'll give that a second or two to update. I suspect the BN is going to be pretty small on that. And it looks like the results are coming across. 14% were the VP and 86% were not at this time. Okay, so this will really show a lot of you the process on what it takes to get a job in and run it through. And those of you that have the VP, hopefully this will be some a little bit of review for you, and maybe I'll hit a couple points that you hadn't seen before. So the second question should be coming up here. And what type of products are you currently producing with your VersaCam? I understand those of you that don't have one right now, so this is probably a pass for you guys, but we'll give it a minute for everybody else. And the answers on there are garments, sign media, and combination of both. Most of the shops that I go to when I'm doing installations or tech assists or anything like that, a lot of them start out with the garment area and progress on into sign media until it comes to the point where they're using the VersaCams for just about everything. It truly is a versatile piece of equipment, and I'm very avid about it, and I love this piece of equipment. So here come the results. And 60% of you out there, as I suspected, said use it for both. We've got an even split on the garments and the sign media as a majority of it. So a combination of both, definitely, no surprise there. So let's take a look. I believe we have one or two more questions. And what type of training have you received with your printer and software? For those of you who have it out there, have you gotten the setup only, the day training where somebody came out and installed it and hooked it up to your computer? Did they do an on-site half day after that or a full day after that? Or off-site, got some workshop or something like that out there, like the VersaCam training that we have? We have a two-day hands-on course for it, and we're also looking into other types of training, depending on what people out there are looking for. So should be fairly quick on the results with this one, too. And this is the last question, so after this, we'll jump right in. And most of you had the setup only, didn't get a whole lot of training. So for those of you who did get set up only, please, this webinar will help you out quite a bit, I hope. And make sure you follow up with me afterwards, and we can look into other opportunities for you, maybe some other videos and resources out there so you can get some more training. And then looks like one, maybe two people had an on-site half day. So very good. Thank you for your information from everybody. Like I said, we're going to go into VersaWorks. We're going to do a quick overview right now what VersaWorks is. VersaWorks is a RIP software, which means it's a raster image processing software. It is the control point between your graphics program, the computer, and the printer. It allows us to take whatever graphics we have, apply different settings to it, and then get that over to the printer in a format that it understands how to lay down the different inks, what droplet sizes to do, how fast it needs to go, what color changes it needs to do. Everything that the printer needs to understand is what this RIP software does. It's a, like I said, a control point for the printer, We can send through other programs. I could configure Corel Draw or Adobe Illustrator to send to it, and there's other ones out on the market that do the similar process of this or other RIP softwares. But this is the one that comes bundled with the VersaCams, and it's a very powerful piece of software and can control just about anything you can imagine with it. It is not a graphics editor. If you're looking at this program and thinking that you're going to be able to bring it in and change text in a graphic or change a star over to a circle or anything like that, it is not a graphics editor program. It is a RIP software, and it's our control point over to the printer itself. So very important to understand that. The first part to any of this process is the graphics, what we're going to bring into VersaWorks. I have to have something that has been created with a graphic software, whether that's Adobe Photoshop, Corel Draw, Adobe Illustrator, CADWorks Live is another option out there, which is a free program that you can use to set up graphics. There's many different types out there. But remember, VersaWorks isn't a graphic software, so we need to create or get these graphics from something else. So the type of graphics that VersaWorks accepts are EPS, which is encapsulated PostScript, PDF, portable document format, TIFF, and JPEG, whereas the EPS and PDF can contain vector graphics and vector data, and the TIFF and the JPEG are strictly raster graphics. So a raster graphic is anything that's not vector, which would be something that's taken with a photograph, scanned, anything like that, to where when I zoom in, I can see the pixels on it. Whereas the EPS and PDF, they can contain both raster and vector, whereas a vector is a scalable graphic. I can make it 2 inches wide or 20 feet wide, and it's going to be as crisp and clear on both of them because it's a mathematical solution and not a bunch of pixels. So that's kind of another topic later on for what the graphics are, and we do have a good webinar out there about Corel Draw. It talks about that a little bit. So, but most importantly, we need to make sure our graphics are set before it comes into VersaWorks. And in this webinar, we're going to be talking about VersaWorks, so we're going to say that your graphic is set. I do have Corel Draw open in the background, so if we have time at the end and somebody wants to see, I can show them the cut line and some of those process. But we're going to go forward with the understanding that the graphic's set and it's ready to go into VersaWorks. So, first thing in VersaWorks is we have these queue settings. I'm going to go over the slides and then I'm going to jump into VersaWorks and show you what I mean by each one of them. The queue settings are a set of file folders that allows us to control what's coming into and out of VersaWorks, and we can apply different settings to them. We want to take a look at spot colors, media profiles, and printing of color charts, because there's some different settings we have to do for that. So I'll jump into VersaWorks right now, and you should be able to see it on your screen. Here's our representation of the printer and the computer going over to it. And these two file folders here are what our queue settings are. These are the queues, or folders where we can store jobs when we bring it into VersaWorks. What I mean by queue settings is these are the settings that are applied to any graphic or file that we bring into VersaWorks as it's brought into that folder. Some of these cannot be adjusted after the fact. Some can be adjusted after the fact, but for the most part, this is what is applied when it comes through. So we can either double-click on the queue folder itself, or I can go to Edit and to QA and QB settings. So we'll look at the QA settings right now, and it's going to open up this dialog that gives us all the properties, where I can see my layout of it. You can see some of the things like this orientation. Let's wait for the screen to update a little bit there. The orientation right here, you can't adjust it right now because that's done after it's brought into the queue. One of the most important things in here is under file format. For those of you that have VersaWorks and VersaCam already, I encourage you to go check this after the webinar. Right here, this EPS margin. On encapsulated PostScripts, if I bring in a graphic and my cut line goes to the edge of that graphic, sometimes it can get clipped a little bit. And if it's clipped, it doesn't complete the cut line on there. So I need to give it a little bit of margin or a little bit of space around that graphic to make sure it doesn't get clipped. I typically set the margin at 0.1. It makes it easy for me to calculate differences in measurements later on, and it's just something easy to remember. It gives plenty of space around it so that I don't have any of these issues. And then the convert spot colors right there, I always check it in my queue settings. That is, if later on in a further webinar we may talk about the Roland VersaWorks spot color library. If I'm using that to get an exact color match out of the printer, it's very important that this is checked so that it does that conversion for us. But as you can see on down the line, I could go in here under my control color management and set my color controls for everything that's brought into it, my media type. There's a lot of different things I can do with the queue settings, but the most important and one thing that I stress over and over with people during all my classes is on that file format tab, making sure that there's a margin set and that the convert spot colors is checked. So you could set these for both QA and QB. You might be a shop where you're doing a lot of banners, and you're using QB for all your banners, so on that one I could go to my quality and tell it, hey, I'm just going to be doing banners, so I want to have a banner profile selected, and I can select that banner profile. I'm using glossy, calendar, vinyl, or something like that, a textile heat transfer right here, because that's all I'm doing out of that queue. So I could set that in there. But for right now, we'll just use a generic vinyl for the webinar. Okay, so we'll get out of this. And go back to my webinar. There we go. It still didn't do it. There we go. On the queue settings, we talked about the EPS margin, spot colors, a little bit on the media profiles. We're going to get much more into that under the settings. And printing of color charts. When I print a color chart for that Roland spot color library that I was talking about, there are certain settings that I have to do in the queue settings to make sure that it prints out properly. And what we would have to do, we'll go back to that queue setting, is the most important thing that's missed is we want the media type to be the media that we're going to work with. So say on this one I'm working with some pet film or something along that lines. And then under color management, I need to have it drop down and density control only. That's how the color charts are printed. So if I'm creating a media color chart for the Roland Spot Color Library, I need to make sure that these settings are in there. So one thing that a lot of people miss when they print those color charts. We'll back out of that and go back to the webinar. What we're going to do now is we're going to bring a job in, and I'm going to go tab by tab through all the settings, just like we're bringing a regular job in. I'll go back and forth in between the slides on this, but I'm going to concentrate a lot more in VersaWorks itself, and then we'll go back and check to see if we hit everything. So first things first, I need to bring that job in. I have a graphic that we created. We'll go to File, and then we're going to add that job to one of the two queues. It really doesn't matter unless I'm using a queue or the B queue to control just a strict type of media, say banners or something like that, but we'll bring it into the A queue for today. So we open up the A queue. I've got this Cheetos cut contour that we're going to run today. I select that one there. Remember, we talked about the different file formats. I've got EPS, JPEG, PDF, PostScript, and Roland VersaWorks files. Those are a little bit different. Most of the time, we're going to get stuff as EPS, JPEG, PDF, and TIFF files. So we'll go with the EPS, and I can see right there, there's my Cheetos cut contour. And I'll click on Open. You'll see it added to the QA, which is right over in here. And I've got my Cheetos cut contour, and I've brought it up to in here. So now I've got this file here, and I noticed an issue, and I did have this problem once before, and I apologize. My VersaWorks, my computer crashed a little while back, and I'm having a couple technical difficulties. For whatever reason, it's not showing a special item in here that would be a cut contour. So I'll have to troubleshoot that later on and see why it didn't come through. But normally I would see a little A there that would show me a cut contour. And then I can see any other special items, say a variable data printing, if I was using that function or anything else along that line. So I've got my Cheetos here. I can get into the job settings by either clicking on the settings tab right here. I can double click on the item right there in the graphic, or I can double click on the item right here for it. So I'll double click on that, and it'll open up a very similar one to what we saw before, where we can see all of the settings and everything that's in VersaWorks. Let me hit cancel on that, make sure this is full screen. There we go. Double click on it, and I should be able to get all of the tabs now. Have that squinched down, and now we can get into it. And I've got all of my setting tabs and everything along in here. So the first one we're going to touch on is the layout. First things first, anytime I'm bringing a graphic into VersaWorks, I have to have the computer and the RIP software communicate with the printer itself. And it needs to be able to find out how much media width I have. It knows that it's a VS300, as you can see over in here. So it's seeing that it should be able to do 29 inches of media width of print and cut. What it's not going to do is update that automatically without me having it communicate with the machine. And we can do that simply by pressing the Get Media Width button. You saw a slight change over in here, graphically representing how much room I have. And you can see right there the width of 27.55. It shows how wide I have on the media. So now I know how much media I have to work with, and I can adjust my graphic as needed in there, and I won't have an overrun on it. Next, I can do any scaling I want. At 100%, this graphic was 2.81 by 1.8. I can change the size. I can simply put in 200 if I want, make 200% the size. I can type in a specific width. Remember that EPS margin that we had in the queue settings, though, I would have to add that to it here. So if I wanted a graphic that was 6 inches wide, so I'll put 6 right there, it would really be 6.2 because it added that 0.1 margin on either side. So I would put 6.2, and now it will physically print out at 6 inches wide for us. So that's how I can do all my scaling. I can even tell it to fit media size, and we'll get this gigantic graphic right here that would fit the media size and fill it all up. But we're not going to do that, and we'll just put it at 6, and now I've got a graphic that I can work with there. I can change the position of it, I can drag it around, and it would physically roll out this amount of media and print and run the job right there. But we don't want that. We'll put it back at the beginning. I can tell it to center in the media if I wanted to have everything centered as I'm printing it. It might be good for doing banners or something like that. I'll unclick that one. And now really is where some of the great controls of this get in, is I can change the amount of the copies that I do along this. So I can run it up here and put a bunch more copies. I'm looking at, I've got some wasted space over there, so maybe I'll try rotating it. I'll use this orientation button. And I've got a little bit better use of space on there where I'm not wasting as much. I can decrease the amount of space in between them, and I've used up even more space there, or I can increase the tile spacing if I need a little room to trim up my job once it's done. This gives you a lot of control about the output from the machine. And also for those different media, say I have a clear media or I'm working with a solutions clear or anything along that lines where I want the output mirrored because it's going to be applied in the reverse manner so it's seen properly when viewed, I can click on the mirror button here and that would mirror the entire job for me. Something to note, you saw how all of these moved when I pressed the mirror button. They're all going to move in conjunction with what I do. They're all going to resize the same. Versaworks sees the one item that was brought into the queue over here, and it will duplicate that all the way across for everyone that's in that. So I need to make sure that if I'm doing multiple sizes that I can add multiple ones in the queue, and then I'll nest them together so I can control them individually. But since we only added one in there, it's going to apply it to everything that's across here, so I'm going to bring that down to 6 across, and that gives me a little bit better room. I can actually take this all the way down and get a 7th one in there and make better use of my space. So that's the layout tab. Let's take a look and go back over to the presentation. Like I said, get media width, we can change the sizing, we can change the orientation, scaling, and multiple copies with our layout tab all the way across. Next one up is the quality tab. So on our quality tab, the things that we're going to look at under here are what type of media we have. We can pick the different ones, and there's not a whole lot in here. I need to do an update on this version of Versaworks. Like I said, I had a computer issue this morning, and I didn't put all the profiles back in here. You would be able to select which profile you want. If I want a heat transfer profile, or I was working with a monomeric film or white glossy photo paper, whatever I'm working with in here, I can pick that media type and that profile, and that is what I'm going to be printing on. This profile tells the printer how fast to print, how to put down the ink, what spacing to put on everything. It's kind of like, I liken it a lot of times to baking a cake. When I bake a cake, I need to know how much sugar to use, how much flour to use, how many eggs, what temperature to put the oven at, so that I get a cake that comes out correctly. It's the same with this. We're making a recipe. We've got this recipe that was created for us for this specific material, and we're going to tell the printer that recipe so it runs it correctly and we get the proper product out of it. So that's what the media type is here. And we'll just pick a textile heat transfer. We'll put that one there, not a metallic one. We'll do textile heat transfer. Now you can see that there's a print quality right here. I'll switch to one that will give us a few more options. On this print quality here, it shows you an estimated time of how long it would take to print that. And you can see when I change the quality here, you'll watch right here the resolution will change. at the standard, which standard is our best performance and best output is kind of a median. If I go to high quality, you'll see that the resolution will go up to 1440 by 720, but you can see it's a lot slower also. If I go to high speed, I'm sacrificing quality for speed. And really, the speed in between high speed and standard on this particular job don't change much at all. It's about 2 minutes for each one of them. The real change on this one was high quality. If I had a much bigger print, we would see a difference between the high speed and the standard settings. I found as a general rule of thumb for almost everything that I run out of my shop that the standard quality works for just about everything and is very acceptable results. I use high quality for a lot of my photographic prints or canvas prints or something that's going to be a really high resolution graphic that's going to be seen close. I might switch over to high quality on it. But for the most part, standard has worked very well for us. So you can see how that portion there determines your resolution and it controls it there. We really don't have a drop-down menu. There are some profiles out there that will allow you to use a drop-down menu here and change the resolution. Also, if I decided if I had a printer that, say, had metallic, like on this one here, I've got now access to the mode right there, and I can tell if I wanted to do just metallic or if I want a CMYK, light cyan, light magenta, or if I wanted the metallic option. And you can see it changes right there. There was no metallics, but if it had metallic, it changes the time that's on that. If I'm doing just a CMYK, it goes to 7 minutes also. So we can control some of those things with this drop-down menu also. And we'll go back to a regular heat transfer one. Our halftone here, this is either dither or air diffusion. Most of the profiles are set to dither. There are some out there that are air diffusion. Dither, it calculates your halftones in the scan direction, which is the direction that the head travels back and forth across the machine. And air diffusion, it will calculate the halftones in the graphic in the scan direction and in the feed direction, the direction that the material feeds through the printer. So it's a bit more involved on air diffusion than dither. I found that the most time that I've used the air diffusion is either with a profile that already has it set, or if I'm trying to do a little troubleshooting on the machine, I look at it and it doesn't quite look right on my output. I might switch over to air diffusion if I've got a lot of gradients and see if that helps correct the problem. But dither is pretty much the default for that there. Our next tab on this is interpolation, and you can see it says nearest neighbor. There's three different drop downs on this, and I could do almost a whole webinar on these three and what they do and how they work. So I'm just going to give you guys the basics of it today. With interpolation, this is any raster graphic. So think of a JPEG or a bitmap or a TIFF that you brought in here, something that's a photograph, and I've got this photograph, it's a 5x7, and I need it into a 2-foot by 3-foot poster. So I'm going to be enlarging the picture. And what this does is, since we're enlarging it inside VersaWorks, VersaWorks needs to use a calculation and a logarithm to figure out how to expand that graphic out and fill the voids that would be created as it's expanding it out, and how to best guess or calculate what those little spaces are going to be filled with so that the picture looks correct and has the best quality as we bring it out. Nearest neighbor ends up giving you a really defined hard edge on your graphics, whereas it is the fastest one out of all the three, whereas bicubic does this very, very complex logarithm that keeps expanding out and expanding out to try to calculate out and get the smoothest, nicest appearing look across it. I use bicubic a lot when I'm doing high-end photographs, if somebody wants a nice canvas print and we're going to be expanding it out quite a bit, where I want it to look very smooth. Almost everything else I use nearest neighbor. For vector graphics, it doesn't matter really on that one because it's a mathematical equation and you're expanding it out. It's going to be the same exact thing as small as it is large. So this is really only for your raster graphics. So that's a brief overview of what interpolation does for you. The direction tab on this one, we have unidirectional and bidirectional. This is basically the print head will run back and forth across the machine, and as it's running back and forth, it can print in both directions as it's going, or we can set it to go unidirectional so it only print when it's going across one way. So that's basically what this one runs down to. Almost all the time I run bidirectional. There are a few profiles out there for some specific materials on the market that require a unidirectional because they're very involved in detailed ones. The one that comes to mind for me is white static cling. On that one, it is a unidirectional profile, and it will default to that. You can make it unidirectional. This will give you a little bit crisper print sometimes. For the majority of the time, though, bidirectional works great. If your printer's calibrated correctly, you will have no issues whatsoever with that. There's this little button here. A lot of people ask me about that one. It says ignore default settings, and it will ignore default settings and give it different head speed and change a whole bunch of stuff around there for you. The way I talk about it in the class that I give, the workshop, is they paid somebody a lot of money, and he spent a lot of time to figure out the correct recipe for this. So why am I going to go mess with it? There are some times you may change that. A tech like myself may tell you to adjust that a little bit to do some testing and see if there's an issue with the machine or the profile, and that's about the only time I would recommend somebody playing around with that. The next one down is our color management. This is a Versaworks 101 kind of how-to on here. I'm not going to get real in-depth on color management. That falls back to that interpolation tab we looked at earlier. I could spend an entire webinar or two or three on color management and how to get the best output from your machine. And I'm more than willing to do that if that's what people out there are looking for, and we can provide that for you. The basics I'm going to go through today is Prepress US and Max Impact. Prepress US is the default for most of the profiles. It's this one right here. And what it does is it pretty much keeps everything the way you have it there. It's not going to change your saturation levels. It's not going to shift your colors or anything. It's just a simple prepress. This is the standard US settings for just about everything. The other one on there is Max Impact. And what Max Impact is it kind of oversaturates or pushes the saturation level out on a graphic where we can get some very punchy yellows, some great reds, and some beautiful blues with it. But it works pretty much only with vector graphics. If I've got a roster graphic and I've got somebody who's got a picture that's an individual with really rosy cheeks and I use this Max Impact, well, now it almost looks like their cheeks are bloody, to put it bluntly. It will oversaturate that red and push that color out too much to where now you've got a picture that just does not look right whatsoever. So on this one here for color management, if it's a roster graphic or has a roster graphic in it anywhere, if it's 90% vector and I have a little bit in there that's a bitmap, I'm still going to use Prepress US because it'll take those whites and any other colors out in there and push the saturation levels, and you'll end up getting a white that looks a little grayish. If it's got 100% vector like this Cheetos right here, I can use Max Impact, and it's going to push that saturation out, and I'm going to get some real punchy colors out of it. Those are the two basics of color management. We could get into the property settings here and really go in depth on it. But for today, what I want you to walk away with is that if it's a roster graphic at all, anywhere in there, we're going to use Prepress US. If it's a vector graphic, 100%, you can use Max Impact. And that one's really a preference. If you like Max Impact and use it and want to keep using it, do so. If you find that you get really good results with your Prepress on your vector graphics too, it's more than acceptable to that. There's no 100%. This is the way it has to be done. A lot of this comes down to user preference. So that's that one there. And we can change the profile from what we had up here. Say we had it locked in as a queue setting and we wanted to change it down here. We can do that also. So that's our quality tab. Let's go back over. Looks like I covered everything that was on the slide here, the media type and profile, quality, halftone, interpolation, and color management. Our next one, color adjustment and file format. These are two different tabs. So color adjustment here, I'm going to give my honest feelings on this one. I don't use it much at all. I can remember two or three times specifically that I've used it in a six-year period. My personal feelings are if you have a graphic that was set up properly and done properly in Photoshop, Illustrator, CorelDRAW, whatever you're using, and you've got your colors correct, you shouldn't have to use this at all. Now, you can do some pretty funky effects with it. I can get into the tone curves, and I can set a couple of points and move them all around, and you should see the graphic on there change. I can drag this one over and get some stuff on there that'll change it all around. You can see it changing up in the corner here graphically. So we could play with the tone curves, apply it to all colors, a single channel. I can take a single color and punch it up a little bit, maybe drag the yellow down here, and it will change the colors output on that. I have used this, like I said, two or three times, and it was when I was getting a little too reddish of a tone on an output, specifically a photograph, and I took the magenta and drug it down to -5. And it actually corrected what I had on the photo. So I'm not going to tell you that you will never use this. But if your graphics are set and they're good from whatever program you're bringing, you shouldn't have to touch this. So that's the color adjustment one there. The file format, remember when we were doing the queue settings in the beginning of this, we did most, if not everything there, the EPS margin and the spot colors and all that. You can't adjust anything now. The file format, most of these are set when the file comes into the queue. So it's very important to make sure that that margin was set and anything else on there before it's brought into. Now, if I had a graphic that had a Roland spot color in it, it would identify that spot color and list it here for me, and I would be able to check or uncheck this convert spot colors and then adjust that spot color and check it and do all sorts of things with it in here. But since this graphic here doesn't have a spot color, there's nothing in there that I'm going to adjust, so it's just grayed out for this time being. So your color adjustment and your file format, there's not a lot you're going to do to them. Every once in a while, you may be playing around with it. If you're using Roland spot colors, you'll be using the file format quite a bit more because you'll be checking those spot colors and making sure they're in there. And at the end of the webinar, if we have time, I can bring in a graphic that has some spot colors and show you how that looks. So that is color adjustment and file format. Now we're going to get into the marks tab. The marks tab, there's quite a bit of different information that we can do on this one. If we see our graphics set up here and you see that there's space in between each one of them, there's no marks right now. I'll select the first one and remember, like we said in the beginning, that whenever I apply something to one of these copies, it applies to all of them. So we'll even zoom in a little bit here so you can see what happens with the marks on it. So we'll zoom in and go back to my select tool. And I've got no marks right now, but when I change to trim marks, you can see that these marks that it created there, it created trim marks for me. So now I could line up a ruler to this. Say I was doing these as some square magnets. I could line up a ruler right across here and take my straight edge cutter and cut right down through them and be able to have all these square magnets. Say this was for the side of a service vehicle and round out the corners, and now the customer has the product back. So it adds the trim marks outside the graphics so that it allows me to be able to do whatever trimming after I've done my print. Next on there is margin marks. Oops, I need to select it. Doesn't do too much when you don't select it. Margin marks. Now this one you can see is a little bit different. When I zoom in on it, the margin marks go in towards the edge. They weren't outside of the graphic in this area here. They're in along the edges of the graphic. So it uses up a little less media using margin marks. It depends on personal preference there. If you want the marks outside of the entire area, if you want along the edges of it, really it's personal preference. A lot of times I'll use the margin marks because for me it uses a little less media and I find it just as convenient as the trim marks. So that's those two there. And the last one on this whole line here is FOTOBA. I still do not know exactly what FOTOBA stands for. I'm going to bring this out so you can see the whole page. You see all these complex lines that are around here, the graphic. What these do is they feed into a type of cutting machine, a FOTOBA cutting machine, and it will read these marks both horizontal and vertically, and then through a series of cutters it has in it, it will feed the entire graphic through there, and it will cut it precisely around these. Now, it's not doing a contour cut. It's doing straight cuts through this. This would be if you're doing flyers or posters. Maybe you're doing some sort of business card or something like that. This is for mostly paper products or along that line. Maybe you're some of your semi-rigid vinyls, that you can have this automatically find these cut lines and then cut it evenly all the way around it. Again, it's not a contour cutter. This is a separate piece of equipment, but this is so that you can add these marks if you have that equipment and be able to run it through that machine. I know some shops that use this that do a lot of the pamphlets and the posters and things like that, and they love it. But again, it is another piece of machinery that you would have to get. So just another option available to us, and I've got everything in there. See how it shifted, and they're not all lined up the way I wanted to. It's not laid out. I can go up to this button right here, and it's rearranged the tiles, and I can put them all back to where they were before. And if I select them all, I can see, yep, they're all lined up just where I wanted them to. So maybe this is a point for me to go through these different items up here. This is an undo tool. This is my selection or pick tool, some people call it. This is the hand tool where I can roll it back and forth. If I was in hand tool, and say I had it zoomed to the width of it, I could move the whole page back and forth. I've got two different zoom tools, a plus and a minus. And what they'll do is they'll zoom into the area, or if I do the minus and drag it out, it'll zoom back out, or it's zoomed into it. If I right-click, it should zoom out a little bit. And then we've got our rearrange tiles. Let me get to a full page right here so we can see the full page. I'm going back to the selection tool so I can grab a couple of these and show you the rearrange buttons. There's two rearrange. This one is rearrange tiles, and this one will give you the best possible. So I click on that, and it brings them all back up. And then the second one there is align tiles. And when I click on this one, you'll see it doesn't move these guys up, but it aligns everything up. So each one of them has its own purpose. It's up to you how you use them. I don't use the align tiles too much myself. I use the rearrange tiles quite a bit. And then next we have the fit to width and fit to page. And the plus and minus does the same thing as the zoom in and zoom out right there. So those are our different controls up at the top. We talked about the marks, and there's two more things on the marks tab here. You've got your crop marks for print and cut alignment. When I click on this one, you will physically see nothing different on the screen, because the marks that it's going to print are outside of the print area. The marks, when it prints it, would be up in this area here on the media, over in here, and then it would go back behind it when it's done with the page of printing. So those marks would be outside of this entire area. We'll use those print and cut alignment marks for if I have a job that I'm printing, and then I need to take it out and laminate it and bring it back later on to do cutting through the laminate and matching up with everything. I'll use these marks for that there. So this machine is both a print and cut machine, and I can print, do something else to a graphic, most usually laminating it, and bring it back to the machine and have it find those registration marks and do the cutting. To do that, I need the crop marks if I'm going to take it out of the machine and do that. So we'll uncheck that one there. The next one down on this is the print job properties, and you'll see that everything's shifted over on me. I've got these little lines that were added in there. Let's zoom in on it so you can see what it says. Hopefully you can read what it says there. It says model name VS, and it gives the serial number and a whole bunch of different information there. I can add all of this different information and keep adding it underneath each one of these prints. So we could print this as a proof, and it'll show all the different items we've done. I can add a notes area and type in whatever I want on this and be able to see quite readily when I don't print it out and save that so that later on I could come back to it. I do know a few shops that use this. There are some people that like it quite a bit. I personally don't, because I save all my files after I've done the settings, and then I can come back and bring it back, and it'll have all the VersaWorks settings that I applied to it still in it. And I'll show you at the end the save settings for that. So I'll unclick that, and it'll remove it. I'll zoom back out to see the entire page, and I can rearrange so it puts all my tiles back where I want. So that's the marks tab. Let's look back. We talked about trim, margin, Fotoba, print and cut alignment, and then the properties one. Printer controls. When I'm doing an installation or the basic training on this, I tell everybody a little bit of a mantra, and I've been chided in the past for it, but I think for the most part it holds true, and it does help out quite a bit of people and makes things simple for them. When you see these three on here that say default media settings, and most of the time this will default to use printer settings, for a new user or general user, I'm going to tell you to use default, default, default. This is going to save you a lot of headache. When you do get a little bit more advanced, we can get into, and we're going to talk about it slightly here, you can get into more of the advanced controls on this, but I encourage people, especially in the beginning, to use default, default, default. What it does is it's going back to that media setting, that quality, the recipe that we talked about earlier, and looks at that and says, what do I need for my temperature? What do I need for my speed? How fast am I putting the ink down? All these different things, and it uses those controls for the feed calibration, our vacuum power, our dry time, the head height, and all of our heater controls. Now, where you might run into it a little bit more advanced and start to get into deviating away from default, 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 most commonly I see is with the heater controls. Somebody's got they're going to go to custom settings, and they've got a banner media that they're having trouble getting it quite dry enough. They might go in there and they might up the printer heater or the dryer area on there, and have it a little bit warmer. This is something that you'd have to experiment with on the machine, because remember, there was somebody who created this recipe, this profile, and tested out those settings. But they may have been, say, in California, and you're in Colorado. And Colorado, say up in Denver, it's a mile high, and you have much different atmospheric conditions than they do in California. Or say down in Virginia Beach, where it's a little bit muggier and more damp, or even southern Florida or something like that. Your heater settings are going to be slightly different. So this is where you may want to start adjusting things to test out and see really what it takes to get it dried properly. And where I would play with that more than less is the dryer area rather than the printer area. You may have to up the printer area to get that to dry a bit more, but this is a bit more advanced in there. So for those of you that are just getting the machine, or when you first start out, default, default, default. You can also change and say you've got a media that's tough to dry, or one that you want to give it a little bit more drying time before it brings it back to cut. I could do the custom settings on other controls, and I can change my dry time right here and tell it I want it to sit out there for 10 minutes before it pulls it back to do the cutting. We can change all of this right in here. Again, this falls back to, this is a very powerful piece of software, and then we can control almost everything on the machine right from here. So this is right where you would do that there under your custom settings. Up top in here, we have the cut sheet after output and use custom settings. I can tell this that every time it's done with the job to run the head across and drop down a sheet cutting blade, and it'll sheet cut it and drop it out there for me. I typically don't use that one, because then I have to have a nice clean area underneath my printer, and I don't know about most of you out there, but my shop tends to get a little messy sometimes. So I don't use that one too much. And I can also use custom settings here to give it a, if I had multiple pages that I was going to print, to change the page space in between each one of them. And that would be the space in between jobs in Versaworks. And I can tell it to print the job over, print it several times, which sometimes you, well, almost all the time you would use with a translucent material, say as like a backlit sign or something like that. So those are a little bit more advanced there too. So let's hop back over. We talked about default, default, default. When not the default, a little bit, just touched on that one. Custom settings and heater controls. Now we're going to jump into cut controls, and I'm going to have to apologize beforehand. I noticed this at the beginning of the webinar that it wasn't showing up my cut, and I have a feeling that when I hop on the cut controls here, it's not going to show the cut line on this graphic. I did have this issue since I had my computer had some issues this morning, and I reinstalled Versaworks, and I haven't troubleshot it. It does show some of it here, but it's not going to show me everything on it. With this job right there, when I take a look at it, so hopefully we'll be able to go through most of it, I can tell it to cut the image boundaries. You see it added a cut line around there. And this is what we'll talk about when you'll hear people say the dancing ants on a graphic. You can see, or marching ants, see how it kind of moves along in there. And how I could tell that the program hadn't recognized my cut line in there was that, number one, it didn't show it in the main screen there, and number two, it didn't show the dancing ants around this. And I had this issue, and I do apologize about that, and we'll do a webinar later on, or I'll get with each one of you after the webinar to show you this if we need to. But the cut image boundaries right there, you can see how it adds that to it. I can tell it to return to origin after print, so I could have this print the job and then return back to origin and sit. I can tell it to, if it was printing and cutting or just cutting, I could tell it to return to origin after cut. And then we can also go to some advanced settings to where I've got my cut settings on the machine itself, and I can also go in here and tell it to override what is in the machine. So I could tell it to do multiple passes with the cutting. I could tell it to change the speed. Mostly what I use in this one is the presser. If I've got an object that I have printed, now I've brought it out and laminated it, and I'm bringing it back to cut, I'm going to need a heavier pressure to be able to get through that laminate and the media. If I do my testing on the machine after I've printed and laminated it, so I know exactly how much pressure I need to go through that, I can leave that set on the machine. But then if I run a subsequent job and I forget to change that back, it could cut through not only the media that I'm running after that that's not laminated, but also the backing, and then gouge into the cutting strip and then possibly chip my blade. So, and I have a tendency sometimes to forget those types of things. So what I'll do is I'll go test the cut pressure on the machine until I find out where it's correct. I'll set it back to whatever default I was using on the machine before. So it's set at maybe 50, 60, 70, whatever I need normally for it. And then on this job where I print and laminate and cut it, I'm going to come on here and I needed, say, 125. I'll type that in there. And what this will do is for that job that it's running, it will only this job, it will override the settings on the printer and it will cut at 125 grams force there. So that way, when the job is done, the machine goes back to where I had it initially set, and I don't have to worry about forgetting what was going on there. I just noticed over here, I apologize, that somebody had added a question here, and it was, does a Fotoba cut work to help with the weeding? I suppose it would. It would cut out the squares for you afterwards. But I think a better job than using the Fotoba and another machine for it would simply be to cut image boundaries, and that creates a little bit easier weed box around the graphic that you can weed into. So that's the way I would do it, rather than, you know, buying a, I think the least expensive Fotoba machine when I took a look at them a while back was around $12,000. And I'm not ready to add that on just to cut up some squares so it makes weeding easier for me. So hopefully that answered your question, and if it didn't, please let me know, and we'll get back to you. So that's the cut settings on here. Unfortunately, like I said, there's an issue with my VersaWorks with the computer crash this morning, and I'll try to get that corrected here. So we'll go back to the advanced settings on there. You couldn't quite see it on there. Let me go back to it. Advanced settings right here. This is the advanced settings we're talking about. Perf cut contour, there's another area that opens up here. Let me see if it updates. The perf cut contour right here, if I have a job that has another set of cut lines in it, what I mean by cut lines, let me jump over to Corel Draw real quick. Here's that Cheetos job. And if you see, you've got this pink line that goes all the way around it here. Let me make sure the monitor updates for everybody, because it's not showing on my end yet. There we go. This line that goes all the way around there, and I'll even zoom in so you guys can see it a little bit better. If I select just that line and I look down in the corner on Corel Draw, it says 100% cut contour. And hopefully everybody can see that there. So hang on a second. Let me adjust something, because I don't think you guys can see it there. Let's get rid of that auto hide the taskbar and see if that bumps it up for you. There we go. Now you can see that 100% cut contour right there, that is a command to VersaWorks. Instead of printing that color, it's going to say, I don't need to print that, that's a command. Cut contour, spelled exactly that way. It doesn't matter what color it is. It could be purple, it could be blue, green, it doesn't matter. It just has to be a spot color named that color. And in VersaWorks, it'll recognize it and say, this is something I need to cut instead of print. And that's where it'll show up in that cut section there, and allow us to be able to do that. So there's another command that you can give it, and I'll right-click on the color here so you can see what it is, and I don't have it open. So it would be another color that I would add in there. Instead of it saying cut contour like this, it would say perf cut contour, P-E-R-F-C-U-T-C-O-N-T-O-U-R, and all the P and the two C's would be capitalized. And when I bring that into VersaWorks then, it would recognize that perf cut contour, and it would give me another section down here where I could adjust the settings and actually cut through not just the media itself, but the backing, and have a perforated item on there that then I can just pop out of it. And it comes up with this really neat decal that I can give to the customer that's already set up, and it's got the out shape around it. And it gives it a lot of punch when you're putting it on a point of purchase display or something like that, and increases the perceived value to the customer. Really, it didn't cost us too much. It will wear down your blade a little bit faster and the cutting strip, but it will add a lot of perceived value to the customer on that. So that's our cut controls. Let's go back to the slides. And all the rest, we're going to go real quick over job management, clip and tile, and variable data printing, because they're a little bit more in-depth and not just a one-on-one type thing. Job management, the biggest thing on here I would say is action after printing is save the job. That would mean that if I didn't have this one to save the job, I could delete the RIP data, which, remember, that's that raster image processing, how it converts the data over something that the printer can use, or I can tell it to delete the job. if I tell it to delete the job when we're done printing this, that job will no longer be in that queue. Now, I don't know about you, but I make mistakes from time to time. I'll admit it. And if I run a job and I look over and go, oh, man, I messed that up, and I need to go run it again, and I handed it delete the job, I would have to bring the job back in, do all my settings over, and everything else. I don't like to do that. So I leave this one at the default that says save the job. Down here it has rip while printing, which means it can do all that processing, that calculating as it's printing. The thing I don't like about this one is if I've got a slower computer, or say I'm using my laptops, or I don't have a dedicated computer for this, and it's trying to process all that, and it's got other items running in the background, it can slow it down or even have it to where it loses its signal between the two because the printer's waiting too long on the computer, and we have a loss of a job. So I don't check that one personally. The clip and tile down here, I can use this one if I'm doing multiple prints that are overlapped, or I need to clip it in. Say this item here, I want to clip the image and bring it in a little bit. Go back to my select tool. Bring it in so I don't have as much white space around it. I can trim this item in using this. So if I had, say, a photograph of somebody and I just wanted their face, I could clip it into that. Or I could tile this so maybe I'm doing a vehicle wrap or I'm doing a mural on a wall or something like that. Again, the clip and tile, the job management and variable data printing, these are items that we could do a whole other webinar on, and there are some videos out there for it. I'll touch real quick, variable data printing, there's not much to see here because it's all grayed out. This would be a feature that allows us to create a field inside that graphic that has a name similar to cut contour, perf cut contour, that pulls from an Excel spreadsheet, and it can put data in there. So now I could have shirts where I have a graphic that has different names of the football players and it fills it in, or serial numbers for an inventory control tag or something like that. Very powerful feature in VersaWorks. It's usually a several $1,000 add-on for RIP software, and they've included it in here as part of the package. What I want to stress is every time that you bring a job in, I'm going to be touching the Layout tab, the Quality tab, Printer Controls, and my Cut Controls. With very few exceptions, I'm going to hit those four buttons every single time, and that will set up my job. Once I've got my settings correct, I hit OK. I can either rip the job, which means get all that data together and spray to send over to the printer, or I can hit print, and if it hasn't been printed already, it will do the ripping, and then it will send it over to the printer. So those are the different tabs. Let me go back over and make sure we've got it. We touched those real quick. And we are on the last slide. We touched on all the tabs for a normal job from beginning to end, and I know it was very fast, very packed in there. Had a slight technical difficulty. Again, I apologize for that. But I do want to stress that this webinar is available later on for you to review. It's hard to soak it all in the first time that the guy comes out and does the install. It's great that we have videos like this out there for people. And there are different places here that I've listed out, myversacam.com, the GarminEdge.com, my YouTube channel. We have the hands-on training, things like that. There's tons of extra things out there that can help you get the education you need to make sure you can hit those jobs and do them that you want. So I know we've run real long into this, and I've tried to cover everything. I'm going to go to the last slide that just has my contact information on here. And hopefully, Nicole, do we have any more questions other than the FOTOBA one?
Actually, we have like a two-part question.
Okay.
Is there a setting somewhere to control how the printer cuts different media? Heat transfers and other media I'm using cut and weed fine, but I'm having trouble weeding regular vinyl.
Okay. It could be taken a couple different ways. The first thing I would do is do a test cut on the media that you're running. Realize that in a catalog it might say recommended cut pressure is 50 grams or 70 grams or something like that. That's based on a new blade in the machine with that media. And your blade's going to get dull over time. So you always want to do a test cut, and that's controlled from the machine itself on the front panel of it. So you would do a test cut and make sure it does that circle and square, and you're able to remove the circle cleanly and leave the square behind. If you're having difficulties with it cutting a certain media, it may be that it's not finishing the cuts on that properly because you need a little heavier blade, or not heavier, a different angle on the blade. Some thicker medias require a more aggressive blade angle, like a 60 degree, and it could be a function of changing that blade and then changing your offset to help. Hopefully this answers the person's question. If not, please contact me after the webinar, and we'll get it sorted out for you.
Thanks a lot, Steve. And that looks like the only question regarding the VersaWorks.
Okay. Wow, I suspected that there was going to be a bunch more. Maybe I inundated them with too much information there. It was kind of fast-paced.
I'm sorry, I do have one more. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay.
So in my VersaCam, there is a button that I don't know what it's for. Base point.
Base point on your, on the VersaCam front itself. Okay. It's not in the software. It's on the front of the VersaCam itself. Base point is the starting point for where it will begin its print and cut or whatever operation you're running on it. So if you have a media, say you've loaded the media and you've got a whole bunch hanging out the front and you don't want it to not print and cut on that portion of it, you can run the media back using the arrow keys on the front of the machine and then simply press that base point. On some of the older models, it had a base point button. On the newer models, it's actually function and then base point. Wherever the cutting head starts, you can bring the cutting head out if it isn't out there already. It's defaulted to that front right-hand corner down right in the edge. That is where it will start its operations. If you've ever used a GX24 cutter or anything like that, it's called origin on those. So the base point is the same as that. It's where it's going to begin everything. And if you wheel it back and forth or all over and you press that, that tells the machine this is its new starting point. Good question.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Yeah, that does look like the end of our questions.
Okay. Again, thank you everyone for coming by this afternoon. I hope this helped out a bunch of people out there. And please feel free to contact me afterwards. I can answer any questions for you on VersaWorks, the VersaCam, how to run the different things. If you've got a question about it, I've either messed it up myself or I've done it successfully at some point, and I know the ways to get it done for you. You can reach me at 518-630-6655. Our website's imprintables.com. My email there is stephen@imprintables.com, and my blog for different projects and activities is thegarmentedge.com. I thank you again, everybody, for stopping by today, and I hope to hear from all of you soon. Thanks a lot.